morning. It's October the 11th, 2020. We're on lesson 6 of our fall quarterly today, and we're once again talking about love. This time, our subject today is love your enemy. Love your enemy, okay? This is something that is very difficult to do. This is something that is counteractive to most of the beliefs that we were raised on in the world. But we are talking about Jesus' law. We're talking about God's law. We're talking about what we are to do as Christians. Love your enemy. And we're going to be coming today from Luke chapter 6, verses 27 through 36. And it starts right off. And verse 27 says, "But I say to you, listen, love your enemies, do good to those that hate you." And after that, Jesus goes on. Jesus is talking to his disciples here. And he goes on to list a plethora of things that we have to do. And I'm going to go ahead and just get into it right now. Love your enemies. It's a difficult thing to do. So why would Jesus tell us to love our enemies? Why would Jesus, even in these scriptures after this, Jesus tells us if someone hits you on your cheek, you give them the other cheek. And the thing about it is, when Jesus was teaching these things, when he was on this earth, he wasn't just teaching them and just saying, do this. Jesus was living it. Because even when Jesus said, turn the other cheek, give them your other cheek to strike, he actually did that. He was struck on his cheek by an enemy of him. And he literally gave him the other cheek. Now that's a physical thing, and that's an analogy as well. Jesus lived both of them. You're supposed to love those who hate you, is what Jesus is saying. So why is Jesus telling us? Why is he saying that we have to love people that hate us? First of all, in Matthew 22 verse 36, Jesus said, "You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, all your soul, and with all your mind. This is the first and great commandment. And the second is likened to this. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. On these two commandments hang all the law and the prophets." So on these two commandments, you love God and you love your neighbor as you love yourself. But you may say, well, that's my neighbor. This is my enemy. It doesn't matter. We're talking about love here. When you love people, you don't do certain things to them. If you can put on love, you can get past so much more. So, he's telling us to love our enemies. He's telling us to do good. He's telling us not to treat them the way that they treat us. Why? This is the answer. Because we're Christians. Because we're children of the Most High God. You may say, what does that have to do with it? Because we're Christians. As Christians, we are called to be different. We're not called to look like the world. We're not called to behave like the world. Now, side note, a big lie that was told that being a Christian is easy. No, it's not. Being one of God's children, being a part of God's army is hard work. We have to do things that the world finds easy. Now, somebody that has wronged you, somebody that you know is against you, Jesus calls you to still love them. You still pray for them. And you don't pray and say that again. You don't pray that God gets them. You pray that God takes care of the situation in his own way. You even also pray that God softens their heart, that God turns them from their wicked way. See, we have so much backbite going on in this world right now that you have people out there praying. This is the sad thing. You have people praying that somebody else falls. You have people praying that their brother, their sister, that anybody around them falls. That they may elevate themselves off of somebody else's demise. We're not called to do that. We're called to love our enemies. Because we're different. Because we're the light of the world. Because we're the salt of the earth. Now listen, the light of the world, those two adjectives right there, the light of the world. Now, just a couple weeks ago, and I'm speaking to my people that's in Mobile and Baldwin County, or anybody that's been affected by these storms in recent months, or just this hurricane season in general. The storms have knocked out our power. And what do we use? We use flashlights. We use lanterns. We use any type of light source to find our way. That light source was our guidance. We as Christians, we have to be the guidance of the world. We have to stand out in front. When the world seems dark, we have to shine our light. We have to love our enemies and show that we can be different, that we are different. We are the leaders of this world. Just like those flashlights, they illuminated your houses when it was dark, even if you had to walk outside. See, you don't know darkness until the power goes out. Because even when the power goes out, when it's nighttime, it's a different type of darkness. When there's no power in the city or no power in your area. When those street lights are not on, it's a different type of darkness. See, I'm from the country. I'm from a small town called York, Alabama, and I drove down some country roads where it's dark. See, I know true darkness. And I've seen what the car lights do, what the light can do. If you know true darkness, you know what light can do. So since you know what light can do, we have to be the lights of the world. We have to love our enemies. We have to show the right way and the right things to do. We have to lead by example, by loving our enemies, by praying for them, by not giving them what they deserve, by showing mercy the same way that God showed mercy. Now, let's talk about the salt of the earth. Now, in the South, especially, salt makes everything taste better. Even when your grandma has cooked the greens or she's cooked everything, I've seen some people, before they even sit down at a table, when they sit down at a table, before they even taste their food, they sprinkle a little salt on it. Because salt alters the flavor. Salt makes things, salt changes the flavor of things. It makes it taste better. Now too much salt can ruin some things, but in our figure, too much salt ain't gonna ruin it. Alright? So you sprinkle a little salt to change the flavor of things. Now, we are the salt of the earth. We are the flavor of the earth. We can change things by just sprinkling a little bit of us on the world. See, we are the Word. We're not the world. There's one letter that separates the Word from the world. That's the L. That's the losers. That's the lame ones. That's the losers. Those are the people that are on the devil's side. That is the devil. He is the L. We say, you taking this L. Well, the devil, he's already taken the L. Okay? Put that in your head. Remember that. The devil has already taken the L. He's trying to convince us. He's trying to convince you. He's trying to convince me that he's the winner, but he's not. Jesus defeated him already. He's taken the L. The loser, okay? He's lame. He's left out. The salt, the sprinkling of the salt makes us the Word. When we can sprinkle our word, when we can sprinkle our lives, what we do to alter the taste, to alter the path that the world is going on, sprinkle a little salt. Be a light in this world. Love your enemies. Do better. We can't do what the world is doing. That's not our mission. And since that's not our mission, doing what the world does and hating your enemies, that's easy to do. Oh, that's easy to do. When somebody wrongs you, you wrong them back. You hate them for the rest of your life. Man, that's so easy to do. That is very easy to do. So we have to be different. We have to take the hard road. Okay? We have to stay on God's path. And so many people think that God's path is just the interstate. It's just traveling this way. No, God's path, it has turns. It has detours. You have to get on this exit. There's an accident up ahead, so God needs you to detour. He needs you to go around. We can't just sit there and do what the world does. Love your enemies. That's what Christ wants us to do. That's different. That's not the world. Like I said, that's the Word. We are the lights. We are the salt of the earth. We have to do better. So how do we do better? How do we do better? There's a couple things you can do. There's several things you can do. One thing you can do is continue to read God's Word and understand it for yourself. Another thing you can do is continue to pray daily. And not only pray daily, okay? pray multiple times in a day. See, remember, we don't have to just fall on our knees to have a conversation with God, because our prayer is simply our communication with our Father. You could be driving down the road, turn your radio off, talk to God, have a conversation with Him. So you're reading your word, you're praying, and not only when you pray, this is what I want us to start doing. Don't spend all that time praying, and as soon as you pray, you get up and walk away. If it's communication, this is a dialogue, not a monologue. Dialogue 2, monologue 1. Monologue means we're doing all the talking and we're not listening. Dialogue means that we're praying and we're listening for God's response. See, that's very important there. Listen for God's response. Let Him speak to you. You've taken this time to talk with Him. Now take the time to listen. So you've prayed. Now you've read God's word. You pray. Also, surround yourself with like-minded people. Surround yourself with like-minded people. Now, I'm not saying don't have other friends, other different people, but surround yourself. Your circle needs to be people that has a goal in mind. My major in undergrad was geography. I was an earth science, so I had geography, meteorology, and geology were the earth sciences at my university, University of South Alabama. Okay, I surrounded myself with earth science majors while I was concentrating on my work, because we had like-minded, even in conversation, or just hanging out. We would begin to talk about classwork. We would begin to talk about things. So it constantly reiterated the things in our head. When you're constantly around people that want to love their enemies and want to put on love, they're constantly talking about it. They're constantly talking about it. I'm a musician as well. I was in the band from fifth grade all the way to my senior year in college. I went to Alabama State. When I went to Alabama State, I surrounded myself with the people that were in the band with me. Even when I was at University of South Carolina, I surrounded myself also in other times with people. But especially when I was at Alabama State, that was a dream for me. I surrounded myself with people that were in the band because we were talking about it when we were just hanging out. It was on our minds a lot. That was a goal of ours. This love thing has to be a goal of yours. And in order to achieve that goal, you have to surround yourself. You have to communicate with those people. Weightlifters, they surround themselves with other weightlifters. People that run, they surround themselves and they communicate with people that run. Whatever you do, whatever you try to be successful in life, you surround yourself with those type of people. So you surround yourself with people who are like Christian-minded, who want to love, who want to first put on love, who wants to first love God, and who wants to second love their neighbor as they love themselves. That's just a few things that you can do. That's just three things. That's three things I'm giving you. Read your Bible. Pray. Surround yourselves. And in each one of them, it's so much more, but we don't have the time to go into all three of those. It's so much more dissecting we can do in just those three things. But today, love your enemy as Christ told us. Because even on the cross, when the enemies were out there, when they laughed and when they mocked him and said, "You're the Son of God, this is your King. What are you going to do?" Even in that, even when they taunted him, even when they beat him a whole night long, even when they put a crown of thorns on his head, Christ said, "Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do." They beat him. They hung him. They nailed him with spikes in his hand and in his feet. Put him on the cross. He still said, "Forgive them, for they know not what they do." The greatest example, our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. True leadership, led by example. The light of this world, the salt of this earth is what we are because we have relationship with Christ Jesus. So go forth, my brothers and sisters, today and love. And remember what Jesus did on the cross for us. Have a blessed day. God bless you, and amen. At this time, I would like to read a thank you note from Pastor and Sister D's to the Sunday School Department. They celebrated their their 21st anniversary with Emmanuel AME Church a couple weeks ago, and I received this handwritten. That's what I love so much about my pastor and my first lady. They are so involved in our Sunday school. They teach in our Sunday school. They're very involved. I mean, they just don't sit there and show. My pastor opens the church every single Sunday, okay? And they have such a love for our church. And this is a handwritten note, okay? This is not just some generic thank you. This is handwritten from them. And I receive one every single year from them, from the Sunday school, and even when I give them things personally, handwritten. Says, Brother Vincent Walker, superintendent, officers, and members of the Sunday School Department, Reverend and I literally can't thank you enough for all that you do. Thank you for your fellowship, leadership, and last but not least, for your generous monetary gift from the church school. Stay in its grip, Pastor and Sister D's. We love you, Pastor and Sister D's. Everybody out there, you have a blessed day. Amen.